we've started out this series on New Year's Day, and we began to look in the book of Philippians, starting in chapter 2 and 3, and begin working our way through the book of Philippians over the last couple weeks. And so in week 1, we talked about the idea of what it looked like for us to set goals for ourselves versus actually a New Year's resolution. So instead of just stating a resolution, what if we were to set goals for ourselves and to play that out that way, that we were to set a goal, that if we were to set a goal for ourselves both personally and spiritually this year for 2017, how different could things look? How stronger could our walk with God be, that if we were maybe to set a goal? And the reason that I told you guys there's a little bit of difference in there for me is that a resolution for me seems like it would just be something that we would, just some words that we state. But for me, if I set a goal for myself, like I've set some goals for myself this year, both personally and spiritually, that if I set some goals for myself, it seems to have a little bit more validity to it, a little bit more concrete for me than just a resolution. And then in the second week of the series, we talked about the idea of, in Philippians 3, where we talked about the idea that we should set an example for people, that if we're in the room today as a follower of Christ, then it's our job to set examples for people, that we should be an example for people to follow. And we're going to see a little bit of that again today. Paul mentions that again today, but we also talked about standing firm. That no matter what we did, no matter what life threw us, no matter what curveball came our way, that if we are a believer in Christ, that we are to stand firm in our faith and stand firm in the foundation of knowing who God is. Then last week, we took this journey as a church and began to talk about where we're headed as a church and where we opportunities that you have in 2017 to get connected to City Place, places that you have to serve here at City Place, things that we need, opportunities that we have, partnership with the school as an outreach, and things that we have available to us. And I told you last week that before you can have a legacy, because we all want a legacy, we all want to leave a legacy, that before we can have a legacy, we have to answer the call. That before Samuel, who we looked at last week, before Samuel had the legacy that he had to answer the call and the sound of God's voice. And so today we're going to be in Philippians chapter 4. If you will turn there with me and look in verse 4, I'm going to begin reading. It says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound, and in any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me." Let me pray for us real quick. God, we love you. And we are grateful for today, Lord. We're grateful for the opportunity as a church, Lord, to be here again to worship and to listen to your word, God. I pray that as we begin to talk about your word, Lord, I pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to how you would have to speak to us. Each and every one of us in the room have different worries and different needs and different circumstances. And so, God, I just pray that your word would break through all of that today, God, and that you would open our hearts and our minds and that we would leave this place different than we walked in. And so, God, we love you, and we praise you, and we thank you. And it's your name we pray. Amen. So today I want to talk to you for a minute about this term that maybe you've heard before, what if. That if we were to play this game sometimes, that we play what I would think called the what if game sometimes. That we've all been in circumstances in our life, we've all had situations in our life that we look back at something, whether it be negative or positive, we look back at it and we say, what if this had happened? What if I had made this choice? What if I had chosen this path? What if I had gone this way? Would things have been different? Now, sometimes, I mean, it can be from the positive or the negative. Sometimes things work out for our favor, and we look at it and we go, whew, man, what if I had chosen that other decision or what other path? What if I had made that other decision? Man, things probably wouldn't have turned out the way that they turned out. But a lot of times it's when things aren't going the way that we want them to that we turn around and we look at the situation and we go, well, what if I had chosen this? Well, what if I had done that? And I think so often we go through life playing the what if game with ourselves, that if we were just to be honest with ourselves and we were to look at things differently and understand how good God is and how that plays out. And so I think so often that maybe the school that we've chosen or a decision we made or wherever it may be, that all the time that we play this what if game, what if I had done this? And so a lot of you guys are, some of you guys are familiar with my story. Some of you guys know a little bit about Kim and I, but I always think sometimes about the standpoint like, what if the place that Miss Kim and I met, what if I hadn't gone back in that night? What if I had just left with my friends, right? Because we met at a bar, in case you don't know that, a long time ago before Jesus. And so, right? So what if I hadn't gone back in and met her, right? What if I hadn't gone back in? What if I had just left? What if I had chosen to go, didn't go into the military and went into a different route in my life where things would have worked out for me? And for me, thinking about some of the what if stuff, what if game that I play with myself, my senior year in high school, which is almost 25 years ago, which makes me feel super old, right? Almost 25 years ago, my senior year in high school, I'm there and I'm doing pretty well in school. That you guys don't know me very well or don't know. I was a pretty good kid, didn't really get in a whole lot of trouble in high school, kind of straight laced, did the right thing, made the right choices, right? Or my mom would have killed me. And so, but my senior year, I got caught up a little bit. I got caught up with the wrong crowd. I got caught up with the wrong people, started making some bad decisions. And as I think back, I wonder how differently things would be. So I went from having a pretty good GPA, lots of great opportunities, other things that were coming my way, that it all really came down for me to this SAT, if you guys have ever taken the SAT, right? I was in ROTC in high school, and I was pretty far up in ROTC in high school, and I had the opportunity, because of my grades and because of everything that I had in front of me, I had the opportunity that if I did well enough on the SAT that I could either go to West Point, or I could get a full ride ROTC scholarship and I could go to any college of my choice and go that route. But it all kind of boiled down to the SAT score for me. And I prepped and I did my thing and I was ready. I felt like I was ready. And I showed up that morning and I took the SAT and I'm like, all I need to do is get 1,000 to 1,200. If I can get 1,000 to 1,200, which is pretty high, if I can do that, then I've got all this out in front of me. And a couple weeks later, the results come in, and back then, you just got an envelope, and you had to wait, and you open up the score, and I pull out the piece of paper to see my 1,000 to 1,200 that I got on the SAT, because in my mind, I've got my plan. I know exactly where I'm going. I'm either going to West Point, or I'm going to Florida State on an ROTC scholarship. Like, I've got my plan figured out, and I pull out the paper to see where it is, and it says 710. And I think you get a 700 for just putting your name on it, right? I think you get a 700 for just putting your name on it. And I pull it out and I look at it and I'm absolutely defeated. Like everything that I had, every dream that I had, everything that I wanted to do, it just fell apart right there based on a piece of paper. And so everything that I had, every dream that I had, everything that I had planned for myself kind of began to just kind of blow up in my face just by me opening up one envelope. And I don't know if that particular situation kind of painted the picture for me for the rest of my senior year, but not soon after that, is when I hooked up with the wrong people and the wrong crowd and began to make the wrong decisions and kind of started to skip school a little bit and started to do some things that I shouldn't do. And I found myself in a situation to where I went from a pretty high GPA to where I was maybe not going to graduate because I had one class that you absolutely had to pass called English. And if I didn't pass that, I wasn't going to graduate. And all of that, and I wonder, and I play that mind or that game with myself of what if. That what if I had made a different choice? What if that score had come back the way that it was? How different would my life look? What different route would I be in? And I think so often in our journey, which is what we're talking about, our journey as people, our journey as followers of Christ, the journey that we're on, the route that we're following, the journey that God has us on, we could play the what if game so much. What if decisions from the past? What if decisions that are in the future? What if situations that we find ourselves in currently? And I believe what Paul begins to paint a picture for us is that if we think about things differently and we look at things differently and we play the what if game differently with ourselves, that our 2017 could look a lot different and God could set us up for success. And so what I want to do for a few minutes is I just want to kind of unpack this for you guys as we look through this a little bit. And so in verse 4, Paul begins to just say rejoice, right? He says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. It's interesting in the word rejoice, in just that small sentence, Paul mentions it twice. In that small sentence, Paul says, hey, listen, I want you to rejoice. I want you to be joyful. Re, as most of you guys know, means to do something in duplicity, to do it again. If I rewind the tape, like sometimes like, man, I messed up in a situation. I'm like, let me rewind the tape and do that situation over again, right? If I want to redo on something, then I'm doing that situation again. From a basketball standpoint, if I get a rebound, then that means I've got my team has an opportunity to take another shot. Like, re means to do something again. And what Paul begins to tell us is that we are to rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. It makes me think often that so often we just don't rejoice. We aren't as joyful as we should be. That we're so caught up in the current situation or the current circumstances around us that we can't rejoice. If you guys remember from week one of the sermon, I told you that the Philippian church is under persecution. The Philippian church is being persecuted. They're under a lot of tension and a lot of pressure and a lot of stress. And Paul is writing this letter to them as an encouragement. And he's been encouraging them the entire letter. We say book, but the entire letter, Paul is encouraging them. And he gets to a spot here where he just wants to remind them again that they are to rejoice, that they are to be joyful in the Lord. Because he says, rejoice in the Lord always. He doesn't say rejoice in the situation that's around you. He doesn't say rejoice in the blessing that you have. He doesn't say rejoice in what's going right. He doesn't say rejoice in what's going wrong. It says to rejoice in the Lord because that's where everything comes from. That our joy should be in God and in Christ, and that's where our joy should be, not in other things. I know so often somebody may bless you and you're so blown away by the blessing, but don't forget where the blessing comes from. And that's what Paul is telling us is rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord always. And then he says, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Maybe your translation says something gentleness. Maybe your translation says something a little bit different. But what Paul is talking about in there in this instance is let your demeanor, let the way that you treat people, the way that you interact with people, let your reasonableness be known to everyone. That if you are a follower of Christ, that if you say, I love Jesus and I'm following him with my life, the way that you treat people, people should know that you are a follower of Christ just by the way that you treat them. That if you blow up on people or you're upset all the time or you're going off on people all the time or you're just mad and you're just frustrated and somebody's taking the brunt of that, it doesn't mean that we're not going to have a bad day because we do. But what he's saying here is that as you interact with people, as you're around people, let your reasonableness be known to everyone because the Lord is at hand. The Lord is coming back, right? This is what he's saying. God is at hand. The Lord is coming back. No one knows exactly the day or the time or when it's happening, but God is coming back. And so the way that you treat people matters. The way that you treat people today, tomorrow, 5 weeks from now, 6 months from now, 5 years from now, whatever it means, that let your reasonableness be known. Because people are going to look at you and know and understand that you're a Christian by the way that you treat them, by the way that you carry yourself, by the way that you interact with people. But he says that after he says to rejoice, to be joyful, right? You ever meet Christian people that should be extremely happy and they just walk around with stank face all the time, right? They just look like the most unhappy people on the planet. It shouldn't be that way. Right? We should be rejoiceful. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. But then he goes on to say, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. That we don't have to worry about anything, that we don't have to be shaken by anything, that we don't have to worry, be anxious, be nervous. We don't have to do any of that stuff. We don't have to worry about those things at all. He tells us not to be anxious about those things. And I don't know about you guys, but I know for me that I am always anxious and I'm always nervous and I'm always worried about what's the next step and what's going to happen. And I know God's got this, but I'm still nervous and I'm still worried. And oh man, I have the gift of faith, but God, what's going to happen and what's going to do all these things? And I've been more anxious in the last 6 months than I've ever been. But Paul tells us that we don't have to be worried or anxious about anything. But in everything we do, that if we pray about that and with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, we let our requests be known to God. Notice what he says, that with thanksgiving, that I think so often our prayer life is made up of worries and burdens and to-do lists that we want God to do, that sometimes we forget about the thanksgiving part. That sometimes we forget about how good he is, that we forget how awesome he is, of how what he's delivered us from, of what he's brought us from, the blessings that are in him, that we forget sometimes to just rejoice, and all we do is come to him with to-do lists that we need from him for that day and to thank, maybe to thank him for a couple things. But I don't know, I know I'm guilty of it, of how often I come to God in prayer time just out of thanksgiving. Almost every single one of my prayers, at some point I'm going to get to something that I'm looking for or need or praying for someone else or whatever that may be. But Paul tells us you don't have to be nervous or anxious or worried about anything. But that if in everything you do, he doesn't say in some of what you do or when you feel like it or when you're really nervous about it. He says in everything you do, to bring that with prayer and with supplication and with thanksgiving, and to make that request to God. And then he says, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. This is a bit of scripture that if you've been around church for a while, you probably have read and you probably have heard quite a bit, and you've heard it preached and you've read it. For me, it's one of those same things. But there's something in this particular verse that I've missed before. Maybe you've caught it. Maybe you know it. I don't know. But I've missed it. But that he says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That as we're anxious and worried and know those things, that we don't have to feel that. We don't need that. We can just bring those requests to God with thanksgiving. And everything that we have, bring those things to God. And this peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. Like, we've talked about that before, right? Even a couple weeks ago, I mentioned to you, ever been to a funeral with a family and they just have a peace of God that they know that their loved one is with Jesus and they just have this peace that you don't get? Or somebody who's going through a storm and you just don't understand how they can be so calm and how they know God's got this and they're not anxious or worried about anything. There's just this peace of God that surpasses all understanding. Like, that part I've seen, that part I get, that part I understand. But the part that I think that I've missed is this last part of the sentence that says, the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. That all the thoughts of negativity, that all the thoughts of worry, that all the thoughts of everything that keep us, all the what-if game that we play in this journey of life that we're in, that if we're praying the way that we should, and if we're bringing those requests to God, it tells us that the peace of God isn't just going to be with us, but that it's going to guard our heart and that it's going to guard our mind. So we don't have to be worried. We don't have to think negative. We don't have to be scared. We don't have to be worried or anxious about anything, because God is going to protect our heart and protect our minds so that we can think of him, because when our mind is on him, our life looks differently. When my eyes are on Jesus, every situation looks different. Every situation looks different. And to me, it's one thing to have faith that know in the end that God has it. But when my eyes are truly on Jesus and I'm focused on him, things are all different. And so for me, it just overwhelmed me this week as I read this to know that if I'm praying about everything with a heart of thanksgiving, not being anxious about anything, rejoicing in the Lord, knowing that I have to set an example for people, but that if I'm giving all of that to God and I'm focused on him alone, that he's going to guard my heart and guard my mind, and I don't have to be anxious or worried about anything. I don't know about you, but that was encouraging for me this week to think about that. Because after Paul sets that up for everything, after he says, hey, listen, twice he tells us to rejoice in the Lord. He tells us to let our reasonableness or our gentleness be known to people. The way that you treat people, it matters. Don't be worried or anxious about anything. Just take everything you've got, every request that you have, and leave it at the altar. And come to the altar, just like we sang this morning, and leave it there for him. And you don't have to be worried about anything. And this peace of God is going to come over you. And it's going to guard your heart and guard your mind against all the negative thoughts and all the bad things that are worried that you're worried about. To me, like, we could stop right there and just take that and chew on that this week, as I always tell you guys, and you would be good all week if you really unpacked that and really thought about how that applies to your life. Because to me, there's so many of us that are worried about so many things. We're so anxious about so much stuff. I mean, over the last few weeks, I've shared with you guys, like, man, God, I just wish I knew what City Place looked like in 5 years from now. And God's like, why don't you just deal with Sunday, like right here? Why don't you focus on your message for this Sunday? Why don't you do these things? But so often, we're so anxious and so worried and so caught up in what we think is going to happen, or why am I in this situation, or why is this happening to me, and why can't I get a breakthrough, and why won't something open, and why won't this happen, and why, and what if this, and what if that, that we get so caught up in all of that that we forget about the Thanksgiving part, and we forget about the peace of God. And we forget about where those blessings and where those things come from. This week, maybe if you guys follow the church on Facebook, you saw Wednesday night. That Wednesday morning, I had a really tough conversation with someone on Tuesday night, and I was pretty broken Wednesday morning. I was pretty upset, just didn't go as well as I would have liked for it to go. And on Wednesday morning, I just found myself in my prayer time, like, God, like, would you encourage me so that I can continue to encourage our church? Because I feel like one of my jobs as pastor, especially in the stage that our church is in, is to keep you guys encouraged and to know that we're going to do good things. Don't give up. Keep pushing. Keep help us. Do. Help us, right? I feel like a big cheerleader sometimes, which is okay. Never had pom-poms before, but it'll be all right. And so Wednesday, I found myself in a situation where I found myself praying for encouragement, and I'm praying for confirmation of God. Like, are we moving in the right direction? Are we doing the right thing? Like, I just had preached the message, the vision cast for you guys on Sunday. Tuesday, I have a horrible conversation. And then Wednesday, I find myself praying for encouragement and confirmation in the direction the church is headed. And I pray that Wednesday morning, and man, probably about 2 hours after that, like, the floodgates of encouragement just opened up. Not just for me, but for our church. Cassie calls me or texts me and says, Dad, we got a card from Grace City Church here at the school. Can I open it? I said, sure, you can open it. I was like, that's kind of weird, but yeah, you can. What would Grace City be sending us? So Cassie opens up the card and she reads the card and it's like, hey, City Place Church, thank you so much for serving the city of Lakeland and for loving the city. Congratulations on your one-year anniversary. Keep serving. And there's a financial blessing in there from Grace City Church for us, right? What other church is sending another church money? That doesn't happen, guys, in case you don't know, right? And then a couple other things happen. Kim calls me and says, hey, did you see this or did you see that? Or, hey, I heard this or so-and-so. I want to encourage you this way. Listen, what I just heard, think about this. We had some people give for the first time at the church. They tithe for the first time. So that's awesome. I'm like, okay, cool. That's good. And then a couple hours later, I get a call from this guy. And he goes, hey, this is Mark from Edible Arrangements. If you guys don't know what edible arrangements are, it's like heaven in a basket, okay? It's like fruit, like in different shapes and like these fruit baskets. So instead of flowers, you get these fruit baskets from heaven. Promise, like manna, right? And so it's got chocolate-covered bananas and strawberries and cantaloupe and all the stuff in it. It's really, really good. I was going to share it with you guys today, but my family killed it. So I get this call from Edible Arrangements that says, hey, this is Mark, and I'm at your church, but there's nobody there. And I'm like, well, where are you at? And he said, well, we're at the church across the street from the elementary school. Are you this Assemblies of God church? And I'm like, oh, no. Our church meets inside the school. We have an office downtown, but our church meets in the school. So anyways, guy ends up bringing it to my house. My neighbor takes it for me because we're not home. And my neighbor texts me and says, man, this thing is beautiful. I'm like, do you know who it's from? And she said, let me pull the card. And so she pulls the card and it says, City Place Church, I'm paraphrasing a little bit, congratulations on your one-year anniversary. Keep loving, keep serving the city of Lakeland. You guys are going to do great things. We have no doubt. Pastors Scott and Cindy Thomas from Free Life Chapel here in town. And I don't know if you guys know this or not, but I'm part of a group of pastors from all over the city of Lakeland that get together once a month and just pray for our city, all different denominations, all different sized churches together, just praying for our city, trying to figure out how do we reach the 200,000 people that we're talking about in the city of Lakeland that are far from Jesus. Well, in our meeting last week, I said, man, I'm so pumped and excited. City Place is celebrating their one-year anniversary on Sunday, this and that. And then another church, Redemption, is doing that as well in just a couple weeks. And so Grace City and Free Life took it upon themselves to bless the church and to bless us. And so what a huge encouragement, right? But so in that moment, I was so thankful for what Grace City did and for what Free Life did that I was focused on the blessing and not where the blessing came from. And so when Paul begins to talk about us rejoicing in the Lord always, to pray about everything and to give God everything that we have. But then Paul begins to go on and he says in verse 8, finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. He told us in verse 4 that we were to rejoice in the Lord always. And I don't know about you guys, but when I'm focused on God and my eyes are on Jesus and I'm looking at that and I think about his character and who he is, God is true. God is honorable, God is just, God is pure, God is lovely, God is commendable, he is most certainly excellent, and he is definitely worthy of our praise. And so for me, when my eyes are on God and when my mind is on him, then my thoughts are going to be different, my actions are going to be different, I'm going to be better, I'm going to be a stronger follower of Christ if I've got my eyes on him and where we should be. And Paul is telling them, hey, guys, listen, I know you're going through a lot. I know that you're being persecuted. I know that it seems like the walls are coming down around you and everything seems to be falling apart. As he encourages them in this letter and he gets to the spot in the letter and he reminds them to rejoice. He reminds them to pray. He reminds them to focus on God. And he says, listen, if your minds are on this, if you will set your minds on the good things, the things that are true and just and honorable and lovely and commendable and excellent and worthy of praise, that if you think about these things, then your journey is going to be different. You don't have to sit back and go, what if, right? What if I had made this choice? What if I had chosen this path? What if I had done that? That if our mind are on these things, if we're making the right choice, the things that are true and just and pure, if we're thinking about those things, then we're probably more than likely always going to make the right decision. Wednesday night in our youth Bible study that we have, right? Josh is leading our students on Wednesday night and we're in here and he had this thing on Wednesday where he said, guys, listen, and he's talking about sin and he's talking about some other things and he says, listen, you have my way, and he holds up one hand over here, you have my way or you have God's way. So when you're making a decision, if you choose my way, your way is going to lead to sin and destruction and all these things. At some point, you're going to make the wrong decision. But if you follow God's way, then you're going to always make the right decision. And to me, it's the same thing, that if we're focused on us and our selfishness and where we're headed and worried and anxious about so many things, we're always going to be leading down the wrong path. But over here, if we choose God's way and our mind is where he should be, then we're headed in the right direction. Our journey is going to look different. Our what ifs are going to be different. And then Paul goes on for the next couple verses and he says, hey, listen, I set an example for you. What have you learned from me? What have you seen in me? What have you seen me do? What have you seen me act? How have you seen me carry myself? How have you seen me do different things? Like, I've been an example for you, which goes back to what we talked about a couple weeks ago, that we as followers of Christ are to be an example for people. And Paul, again, is reminding the Philippians that, listen, I mean, don't forget that Paul is in prison when he's writing this letter. Like, there's probably not a worse situation that you can be in than being beaten and in prison. And he's writing this letter to them going, hey, listen, you've seen the way that I've lived my life. You've seen the things that I've done. You've watched how I've lived my life. And so if you can pattern your life after me and just the way that I'm always focused on God and focused on what God wants from me and through me, if you can focus on those things, then you're going to be all right. Follow my example. And he goes on to tell them thank you. He goes on to tell them, hey, listen, I know that you're concerned about me. I know that you're praying for me. I'm not telling you that I'm in need right now, but I know that you've been worried about me and you can't get to me. You don't have the opportunity to come and serve me and help me. But I want you to know that I've learned to be content. I've learned to be content in where I'm at. I've learned to be content where I'm at and the situation that I find myself in and the things that are happening around me. I have found myself, because I'm always thinking of the Lord, I have found myself to be content. That I know what it's like to not have much at all, and I know what it's like to have a whole lot. I know what it's like to be hungry, and I know what it's like to be full where I can't eat anymore. I know what it's like to have so much, and I know what it's like to be needy. Paul is telling the church, the Philippians, that he knows exactly. He's been on both ends of the spectrum. That he's been over here where it hasn't been very good, and he's been over here where it's been amazing. And either way, or anywhere in between those two ends of the spectrum, he knows without a shadow of doubt, he has learned how he is to be content in all situations. And so then he gets to the verse that is so many people's life verses, and so many people love this verse, and that I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And if I'm being really honest with you, and I hope I don't step on your toes with it, but so often that verse is taken so much out of context, right? It's taken so much out of context. Like, I could walk out to my car when we leave today underneath my minivan and say, God, you know, I can do all things through God who strengthens me, and then try to flip over my minivan, but it's probably not going to work, right? But so often we walk into a situation, we walk into things, and we're like, I can do all things through God who strengthens me, and you can. But what the context of the verse, the thing that Paul is trying to say, what Paul is trying to let the church know is, listen, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me, because I've been on both ends of the spectrum. I've been broke and hungry, and I've been rich and full, and everywhere in between. And so no matter where I find myself and no matter where I'm at, I can be content in that. And I know that I'm going to be able to get through it because of the strength that God gives me. It's not necessarily a verse that we always use no matter what situation we're walking into, but Paul is saying, hey, listen, I'm going to be content. I know what it's like to struggle. I know what it's like to be hurt and to be beaten and to be in prison and all of these things. But I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. The reason that I've been able to not get too high when things are good, and the reason why I've been able to not get too low when things are bad, is because of the strength that God gives me. And I can get through any situation in that. And so as I thought about this verse, and I thought, are these verses, and I thought about what it looked like in our journey, what does it mean for us? How do we wrap things up? We've set goals, and we've talked about being an example, and we've talked about standing firm no matter what life throws us. We've looked at the church and what it takes and where the opportunities you have to serve around this place each and every week and during the week. And we get to a point today, and I guess it was Friday night, like, God just woke me up at like 12:30 in the morning with the term, what if? And finally, like about 3:30, he finally let me go back to sleep. So for 3 hours, I just laid there in bed thinking about my life and thinking about all the what if situations, thinking about all the choices that have gone right. And I'm so glad I didn't choose this path, and so many things that haven't gone right that, man, what if I had chosen the other path? But everything in the end is going to work out for God's glory. And it doesn't necessarily mean that every bad decision that I've made, that was God's plan. I think sometimes we make a mess of things and God lets us sit in that for a little bit so that we can learn. I think so often something happens and God says, hey, why don't you just sit in this for a little bit so that you won't make that same mistake again. And so often we play this what if game. But as we think about our journey, and as we think about the things that we're doing, and we think about the things that are happening in our lives in 2017, what if we were to rejoice more? What if we were to be a better example for the people around us? What if we weren't to be anxious about anything? What if and everything we prayed about it with thanksgiving? What if we allowed the peace of God to guard our hearts and our minds? What if we thought about things that were true and honorable and just and pure and lovely and commendable and excellence? What if we learned to be content in every situation? And what if we allowed the strength of God to help us get through whatever the situation may be that we're in? And so my thought for you guys this morning, my challenge for you guys this morning as we wrap up this series, the idea behind it for me always was that we are on a journey. All of our journeys are in different places. All of us have different struggles and different worries and different things that are happening in our lives. And so often our lives and our journeys take us in different directions. But the idea was, what if our journey could be different this year? If you guys were here in week one of the series, I talked about the idea that coming out of 2016, I heard from so many people that this was the worst year of my life. Man, I wish 2016 could have just been different. I'm so glad 2016 is over. And there were a lot of bad things that happened to a lot of people that I'm really close to. Deaths in the family and all kinds of stuff. But my hope is that as we look at 2017 and we set our journey, that if we look at the journey that we're on personally, we look at the journey that we're on spiritually, and we set goals for ourselves, that we could be closer to God this year than we've ever been. That we study more, that we pray more, that we reach out to people more, that we don't isolate ourselves anymore, that we find ourselves in a situation that when we start to feel isolated, that we reach out to people. Because Satan does bad things in isolation to people. That this year would be different for us. That we would set a different journey for ourselves. That we would set goals and be an example and stand firm. Because there's so many of people in our church that are going through so much. Don't let those things rock your faith. Stand firm. Join us. Be part of what we're doing. Help us build the foundation for this church as we set forward into 2017. There's so many areas to serve. There's so many things to do. But my hope today is that when you're faced with situations, if you begin to play the what if game with yourself, that we would look at the scripture a little bit different, that we would rejoice more, that we would pray more, that we would set our mind on the things that Paul lists in here that are true and noble and good and pure, worthy of praise. I mean, it's hard to make the wrong decision when you're focused on God. But let us be content. Sometimes things aren't always going to be great. Sometimes things are just going to be tough. Sometimes there's a lot of hard work that we have to put in, and sometimes we just want to get through that. Not only personally, but in our spiritual walk with God. Sometimes we're out in the wilderness, sometimes just wandering around, and it's really hard. But I promise you this, no matter where you sit in your journey, no matter whether you're in the wilderness or whether you're on the mountaintop right now or whatever's happening, that God's using that to grow you and make you and build you and to do great things in you. The biggest mistake that we could make is to quit, is to stop short of what God has for us. And so that's why I told you guys the first week of this series that my term or my theme for this year was to press on, that no matter what comes my way, we're just going to keep pressing on towards what I believe God has for me and for my family and for this church. But let us learn to rejoice more. Let us be happy about the difference that God's making in our life. Let us rejoice about the good things. Let us pray more. Let's focus on Him. And let's learn to be content with where God has us, and why does God have me here, and what is He trying to teach me in this moment? Because He is a good, good Father, like we sing often. Sometimes a good father just lets you sit and learn your lesson and figure out what am I trying to learn in this situation. And I believe so often that God is doing that for us. And so I'm going to ask you guys to close your eyes and bow your heads for me for just a moment.